ReleaseWire helps businesses connect with interested journalists and bloggers. Check out the link in the description to save 25% on your first press release.
Admiral, radar shows that we have liberals approaching at 3 o'clock, and libertarians at 9 o'clock, and conservatives at 6 o'clock. They're coming from every angle, every viewpoint.
Oh, it's Political Radar with your hosts, Rhonda and Elliot.
Hey, all you political junkies, welcome to Political Radar, the best 30 minutes of unscripted and uncensored political talk you will hear all day. We have a school board election coming up on April 4th, as well as a referendum on the ballot. So we decided to have two school board candidates join us in the studio today. Welcome, Laura Mccoy and Heidi Fagre.
Thank you.
This is your first time running, both of you.
Yes.
Correct.
For any office at all.
Any office at all.
So obviously the question is, why are you running? Laura, we'll start with you.
Well, it's something I've been thinking about for a while, kind of in the back of my mind that I'd like to run for office someday. But to be honest, it's a part of it is just a desire to get off the sidelines, stop complaining, take some action. There's a few things that I would like to focus on. One is teacher retention. Our teachers are leaving. And that's a huge drain on our school system. And also I would like to amplify the link between strong public schools and our local economy. I think that's something that people don't talk about enough. It's very, very important. And the public schools are part of the talent pool that our economy draws from. And encircling all of that is I'd like to try to change the corrosive language that surrounds education now. There used to be a time when there wasn't this thick layer of politics over it. And I'd like to get back to talking about it in real terms and not just negative terms. There's a lot of really good news in our schools, and we should be focusing on that, not just some of the things that still need to be worked on. So that's part of the reason that I would like to be on the school board.
Great. Okay, Heidi?
Well, I'm in a time in my life. Next year, my kids will be in school full time, and I'm looking for the next step for me. I've been a stay-at-home mom for 10 years. I was a teacher for 10 years prior to that. So I discovered there was an empty seat that will be coming up during the election this year. I'm really passionate about education. I spend my spare time researching and learning about education, the best way to teach kids. I maintain my teaching license, so I'm constantly researching, and I just find that I really want to be a part of the decisions that help all kids learn. We have a lot of kids that I think get kind of lost, and they don't fit in the typical box of a regular student, and I actually have one of those students in my family, and so I feel like now is a good time to step up and speak out for him and the other kids that maybe don't sit well in their chairs all day. I also am really concerned about kind of the overall attitude towards public schools right now, considering our Secretary of Education is trying to eliminate public schools, and the voucher programs are very prevalent, that I really want to be someone who can speak out on the importance of public schools. I am someone who benefited greatly from public school. I grew up in poverty, and the way I broke the cycle was through public schools, and so I just want to continue to be an advocate in that area.
Don't you think it should be local, though? Control of schools should be local?
Well, yeah, mostly to a certain extent, yes.
Yeah, because I don't hear anybody saying that they want to get rid of public schools. They want to get rid of federal funding for public schools.
How would we fund them if we didn't have anything like that?
the way we fund them now, and these guys are well aware of that, right?
But in general,
property taxes,
right,
and income taxes at the state level.
Okay, but yeah, we also know that we operate on a deficit on a regular basis. Okay, that's a fact.
At the federal level, the worst of all. Yes.
No, actually, Green Bay schools operate on a deficit, and part of the referendum that's being discussed at this point in time, that's going to be on the ballot, is what they've thought about doing is adding on another $16.5 million of additional spending to make up for the deficit that's there right now. Because what does that mean when we have a deficit? That means we have staff cuts, we have larger class sizes. So who directly, you know, is the recipient of that? Children, right?
Correct.
And so let's
unless we modernize, we have modern things like Khan Academy that other school systems use as a basis of their curriculum, so that you can have lower skilled people as tutors. You don't have to. You're never going to hire the best.
Who has that?
There's some charter schools in California that use that.
Okay, that's not in Wisconsin though.
Oh, okay.
No, I mean I don't know why
we can't lead, but yeah. And you can also do recording of, you know, much like lynda.com. If you record the best people, the best teachers teaching, and then you have one-on-one either students or faculty helping students more one-on-one with the things they need help with, you can absorb some of those staff cuts and modernize. You know, all other facets of American life have had to grapple with modernization and efficiency and technology.
So what's happening right now, actually, at the state level, is there's a budget obviously put forward, and they are asking for $300 million in vouchers. Mm-hmm. And that would be going obviously towards private schools in Wisconsin. The governor recently said he was going to offer $649 million to public schools. An interesting way, if you look at the math, that you would take $300 million away from that, essentially. So, you know, what is your stance on vouchers? What do you think is happening with...
Why'd you change the subject?
No, I'm asking about... This is actually... These are things that some of the people in the community
have asked. So we don't need charter schools if we modernize and make our public schools better. I think we would all be happy with that.
And that's a great idea. But right now, what's on the
table... So what are we going to do with that?
But what's on the table right now? What's on the table at the state level? Well, what's happening?
I don't mind addressing that a little bit.
Go ahead.
Because, I mean, so basically you're saying using technology to educate people and children.
Because they do it anyway. You know, kids, what do they do when they go home? They watch, you know, as many hours as you let them of YouTube, right?
But I think you're discounting some of the other aspects of public education and what public schools...
Not at all. I'm not saying they should go home and watch TV.
No, I'm saying that schools represent so much... Yes, they're a place where children go and learn every day. But that community addresses so much more. I mean, it's also a meeting place for our community. It's a focal point for our community. It's a cultural focal point for our community.
I want to touch on that too.
It's where people go for sporting events, cultural events, drama, music, those things.
Some children go there for a meal. Can we talk about that?
Yeah.
Let's talk about that the chopping block as well. And that's something that's happening right now.
Well, we already chop out our citizens from going into schools.
Okay.
So in the name of safety, we've never had a citizen walk into school and open fire or steal children. None of these things have ever happened.
Are you talking about in Green Bay?
Anywhere. They've not happened in the United States. Everyone who has ever been involved in a shooting would have been let in the front door by the gatekeeper every single time, including the time at East High School, you know, where we didn't have a shooting. It was preempted. And me as a citizen, I can walk in there dressed as a business person, dressed as a dad, and I get interrogated when I walk into school. And
I think the kid at Sandy Hook, though, just walked in with a gun and shot his way in.
Yeah, and what was his affiliation with the school? He wasn't just a random person from the street. He would have been let in anyway.
He was a person who had no real reason to be in that school.
He wasn't a
staff person.
No. Yeah, but his mom was.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean he would have been
let in. Sure. Okay, so there's one example. He got one example.
Okay.
Right? But all the rest of them have been students. The students are let in all the time.
What's that an example of?
Well, we're locking out parents, and then we wonder why we have these problems permeate?
I can say for a fact, and I can say this with straight confidence, that I am, you know, at least at my school, I can say this for sure. Majority of parents are very happy that they actually added, because it wasn't in long after Sandy Hook that they added that mm-hmm. element to security.
Yes.
It was overwhelmingly, thank you. So let's go on to school lunch.
Well, we don't have it at UWGB. We have it at our high schools, but okay. Not at UWGB.
And part of these referendums would be upgrading the security on schools by giving them, the rest of the schools that don't already have it, a secure entry. And right. And I just want to tell anyone who's watching that I am in favor of that.
Thank you. And I think
we have it at UWGB then?
If you took a poll, can we just say this? If you took a poll of people, and I would love to do that, I think majority of people would feel better having security for their children versus not having security.
People always love trading security for freedom.
And once once something goes terribly, terribly wrong, it's too late.
Okay, so all right, ladies, so you're on the ballot. Let's talk about some things that are actually being discussed and considered at the state level, especially because, you know, they do fund, they do send money our way, they make things difficult or not difficult. So let's talk about the fact that, you know, I want to get back to this. The voucher program is out there, $300 million that the governor proposed from his budget to put into private schools. What do you feel about that? What do you think about that? You know, it feels like it's here to stay to some degree. You know, what are the benefits and, you know, what do you think about that in general? Just your thoughts on it, I'd love to get.
In general, I am not pro-voucher simply because I feel like it excludes a large group of people. It doesn't take into consideration people with disabilities and people who come into life with a lot of disadvantages. And public education is required to educate all kids. Private schools, they can select, they can pick and choose, and they... that's why I am a proponent of public schools. All kids are included. Everyone comes to the table with a different experience, with a different, a different obstacle that they're facing. And public schools are a way for them to get in the doors and get what they need.
And I will say this, I just want to touch on this. So with the Disability Act that's out there in education, private schools do not actually have to, they won't exclude children. I you know, did some research, I made calls, you know, I have a disabled child, I don't, but I just wanted to see what they would say, what's out there. They will allow your child to come in, but they can't facilitate services for them. So if your child has, you know, severe autism or some sort of CP or something where they go and they want to be part of the classroom in a public school, they can enter the building, they can be in the classroom, mm-hmm. but they aren't allowed to have anybody there to help them. They have to bring in their own, you know, facilitator for that purpose. And I think, you know, touching back quickly on the security issue, if I'm a person that's in a public school and I'm a parent and I have someone that, you know, a child of mine is in there with some sort of disability, I feel much safer with the security in the, you know, in the entrance into the building. But I think that's a huge argument with the fact that voucher schools, you know, we want a choice, but, you know, like you said, with disabled children, mm-hmm. they'll take those kids, but they're not going to help them, you know, that's an additional cost to you. Mm-hmm. So the voucher only gets you possibly into the school. If you're disabled, you have to come with an entire package of help.
Correct.
Yes, I would agree. I am not pro-voucher. I think that draws money out of our public schools, and often that money ends up in parochial schools, and I am not in favor of my tax dollars going toward that. I would agree with Heidi that it's not good for our public schools. If people want to... you know, have a private school education, they're entitled to do that and pay for it.
And right now, it's something like $238 million is the Green Bay school budget. It's around $11,000 a child at this point. And, you know, for all intents and purposes, vouchers are siphoning money out of that, mm-hmm. you know, and not helping with that. Yeah. So that's part of the referendum is adding on another, you know, $16 million as well as, let's talk about the...
Well, if a child goes to a different school, how is that siphoning money out?
The tax dollars are being siphoned out of public...
How much?
Well, they want $300 million.
Okay, so for how many students is that, though?
I have no idea. It's on in general for the state. They want $300 million.
Okay, so our local budget is $238 million for local students.
$238 for Green
Bay.
And
they want $300 million for the whole state. Like, that doesn't seem terribly out of whack.
Okay. Well, so but
what
if
happens,
you're...
What am I missing?
So what happens with the voucher, too, after the third Friday count, if a student has used a voucher to attend a private school and they are in some way not... in the school any longer, whether it's they're not meeting the expectations of the school, they get in trouble, they decide to leave because they're not quite fitting in, the money does not follow the student. The money stays in the voucher school.
Okay.
So then that's not
a problem with vouchers. That's a problem with how it's implemented, though, right?
But that's how the law is.
So we should fix that.
We should fix the voucher law, absolutely.
But, that doesn't even begin to address whether or not voucher and charter schools are effective.
We wouldn't know that because they don't have to comply with regulations.
Well,
like
you know,
the schools
the
do.
Thing is, but a lot. Enough time has passed that these programs have been in place, so studies can be done, as far as and have been done, and some of the results have come out rather recently that they don't actually do better than public schools. In some cases, they do profoundly worse, especially like in math and English. So, you know, while you're drawing these resources out of public schools and you're not getting results that are actually, you know, what was promised, basically,
but
was that they're
all
better.
Of them. If you lump all of them together, which was never the plan, right? If you lump all of the charter schools together, they are about the same as regular public schools.
Well, these studies were done. They can't do a national study. They usually focus on in
Wisconsin
averages.
And certain areas. And you know, these are studies that aren't. I've looked at some of them. They're reputable studies. They're not just made up stuff.
Well, there's nothing wrong with comparing average to average, but that shouldn't surprise us that that's going to be roughly the same, right?
I'm sorry, I didn't.
If you have a bunch of charter schools and we're measuring those, and we have a bunch of public schools and we're measuring those, the average should be about the same.
But that's not really what they're marketing it. They're marketing it as a higher standard of education. That is actually how they're marketing it.
Well, they're marketing it as trying new different things, and we're not.
No, they're actually marketing as a higher standard of education.
Oh no, the promises are pretty.
Yeah, that's
pretty
how it's marketed.
Straightforward. So they'll do better.
And in some of them they do.
And of course they do. There are examples, but what statistically the charter schools that do better tend to be publicly funded public schools that are charter. Those are the ones that are doing really well.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But
so, when we think about public schools, they have a standard. They're always, you know, they have checks and balances, where private schools and charters, they don't have the kind of assessments that public schools are required. Their teachers actually don't even have to be licensed. They don't have, you know, there's a lot of things.
Yeah,
that,
well, the licensing thing, that's an interesting thing.
But the reality is, what she's saying is the accountability is not there. So you're taking, again, both schools are taking tax dollars and they're not accountable in the same ways. That's a problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, how do we keep up with Europe? How do we keep up with China? Like, how does this happen if we don't do something? We have to do something to innovate.
We need to do something that works, and apparently it doesn't seem to be working.
But if we're gonna tie our hands behind our back and not allow us to try things, I don't know how we get better.
Well, we're definitely trying the voucher program, and if you're watching closely, which I would assume most people are, it doesn't seem to be doing. It's not delivering on the promises.
So what do we do instead? You know, you guys are running for school board. Like, what would you do instead to innovate? Like, our schools are just devastatingly not improving over the last 50 years. They're not improving. Other schools are in the world. So what do we do?
One of the things I think is giving teachers more freedom to explore their own professional development. A lot of things are just dictated to teachers, and they're told that this is the initiative of the district, when maybe a teacher wouldn't necessarily agree with that and would like to go out and explore their own. I know, like, there's a group of teachers right now who are studying the Finnish system and how that works, and they would really like to implement that and get some things going. And so just allowing teachers more of their own freedom within their classrooms, I think that would be one step, because there's a lot of great innovations that...
So when you're elected, that's what you want to do? You want to implement that?
I would like to. I think that's a part of the teacher retention, is to let teachers be professionals and to allow them their own professional development.
And I think that's a big part of what's missing is that, you know, we used to really hold them in regard and they are professionals. And when you start to strip away someone's profession and make them defend themselves on a constant basis, that is not good for education either. And so
that's what I was referring before about this corrosive language that is surrounding schools now. You know, teachers, they're like any job, right? They want to be paid fairly. They want to have a decent benefit package. They want to have some autonomy in their schoolroom. You know, they want to have some respect, some professional respect. I don't think that's a lot to ask.
And I'm sure nobody would say that every teacher is perfect, but the reality is the language is basically holding teachers as one unit in general. And they're saying that they're a problem, and I think that's just not helpful at all.
So would you be in favor of a meritocracy in teaching instead of whoever's been there longest getting paid the most? Should we pay the best teachers more?
How would you evaluate them? That's where I have an issue. Okay. Is if you're evaluating them strictly on how students do on standardized tests.
Well, how do we evaluate?
I don't know. I don't necessarily agree with.
But we shouldn't evaluate. Like every other profession gets evaluated, right?
Correct.
Heart surgeons get evaluated based on, you know, how many people die.
Private business doesn't get evaluated.
I think you're joking about that, right?
No.
Private business gets evaluated every day in the marketplace.
No, but I'm right. But in their own internal,
they
world.
Absolutely do. Have you ever been to a McDonald's? They evaluate
but
everything.
But these results aren't being put out so that people can rip them apart. I mean, mm-hmm. I think that's the difference.
Well, I don't know that it has to be public. But there should be evaluation, right?
And I think that
we should pay professionals.
But it's going to have to be public if people are questioning why are these teachers being paid this much. I mean, to mm-hmm. some degree, you're always going to have those people critical of it.
We already pay some teachers a lot, and we pay other teachers not a lot, but we base that on how long they've
been doing it. I don't know any teachers that get paid a lot.
I don't either.
Well, they get paid above the median income in Green Bay. That is an indisputable fact. And they get very deluxe benefit packages compared to most people not getting any. So they get
Who are the most people that you're talking about?
The most people.
Yeah. Like
the median income. So the median income is around $40,000 to $45,000 with a very small level of benefits, right? Like, I mean, that's just fact.
So are you saying that elementary school teachers get paid over $40,000?
I no. I'm saying that teachers get paid more the longer they've been teaching.
No, you said more teachers get paid more than the median.
There are elementary teachers that
get paid
more than
$40,000.
Yes, and they get huge benefits.
I would challenge
that number mm-hmm. big time.
Well, yeah. I'll look it up.
Yeah,
it's public.
And the huge benefits, I disagree.
But that's what I mean.
Well.
It's public. Yes. It has to be. I think
okay.
if we're going to
well,
have,
I mean,
we're either going to have transparency or we're not. So.
Well, I don't care if it's public. If we're treating the best teachers the best, if we want to retain people,
but how would you?
If you want to retain people, you treat the best people the best.
How do you decide
who's the best?
Yeah.
Well, that's your job. Like, that's what we need you to do, is to determine how we're going to hold people accountable, improve education, and evaluate it. Like, that's the job, right?
But teachers have to every day be in a classroom with, 20 to 30 variables in front of them. And they teach to those individual children. You can't. You know, those, like I said, they're each an individual child. They each have individual needs. They each mm-hmm. have individual learning methods and
different
so,
support yeah, at home.
But when we yes. but when we have public facilities, we do look at averages. We look at the average street repair. We look at the average wait in a hospital. We wait in the average response time for police officers.
But you're talking about people. You're not talking about...
Everything's people. Roads have to do with people. Police protection has to do with people. Fire protection has to do with people. These are all people. These are all public services. We need to evaluate them. We evaluate everything else. So
I would tell you that public education is evaluated constantly.
Well, you guys said that you want to retain good teachers.
Yes.
Most professional people want to be retained if they're good at their job. Like, they want to be rewarded for being good at their job. And they want
to. I think the opposite of what she's saying, though, what she's actually saying when she says that is she's saying that the.
Well, they're not all good.
Well, no.
They can't be. Or we'd be doing better.
The problem is, and I can attest to this, I have plenty of teachers as clients for the last 22 years, and I can say this. There's a lot of teachers that are good. What she's referring to, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, mm-hmm. is that she doesn't want these teachers to be leaving the system. And that's the problem. Why should they be there when they're being ripped apart, when their resources are being drawn out, when they are, you know, they have disabled children in classrooms, and the money that's supposed to, you know, to be in there to help them is going to the private school who says, we don't really need to help your child. Okay. You know, the reality is, and if anybody wants to challenge this, I'd love it. Schools the resources are being drawn down. They're being mm-hmm. taken away. And that's obvious, and that's been happening for a while. So we want all these great things to be happening, but it's not, you know, be real. You can't have kids that come in there that have eaten once in the last 24 hours okay. and expect them to pay attention. You can't have kids come in and expect them, you know, they haven't slept all night, mm-hmm. right? I mean, what their homes look like has a huge, you know, factor on what they come to school mm-hmm. like and how
or
they
even if they
function.
Have a home.
If they okay. have a home.
All right. So I pulled up a random local public school. I pulled up Martin Elementary. Okay. Mm-hmm. The principal makes $94,381.
The principal is not a teacher.
Awesome. I appreciate that. I don't know why we're paying someone who's not a teacher so much. All right.
How much is it?
So $94,000 plus benefits. All right. And then so we start with teacher number one, $66,514. Teacher number two, $64,829. Teacher number three, $63,740.
Where is this?
This is the 2011 through 2016 Wisconsin teacher principal administrator salaries. Go down the list.
Those are administrators
that year? No, these are all teachers.
Teachers.
They're all making over $50,000.
Does it say what they teach?
Well, there's a number. I don't know how many teachers are at Martin Elementary, but this is a good dozen that are above the $50,000 mark. So, I mean, I don't know what to tell you about that.
And that was 2011?
2011 through 2016.
So that was before Act 10.
Yeah. 2011 through 2016.
Does it say the year, though? Or is it like an average?
That they're doing it for 6 years.
It's just interesting that there'd be like that big span of.
That's not the. It's usually in a school year,
right? What link is that off of?
Salary is the projected base salary as of the date district submitted data to DPI, typically in November. So
is that a DPI website?
Of what year?
This is the Post Crescent database on public schools.
I would just be interested in what year that was.
This is a well-known thing.
Public schools in Green Bay.
That's Martin.
Oh, okay,
Martin
right.
Elementary in Green Bay.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean,
you don't know the exact year, school year that they're talking about.
I don't know. You should look into it and tell me how I'm wrong about that.
Well, no, I think it's an interesting thing to note in general, just to have, because I've...
Does it note how many years they've been teaching?
How that's what I'm getting at. Mm-hmm. Like, who cares? That should not be the metric we're using. You know, we shouldn't
should
be paying somebody.
Should anyone who's in a private business and entity, their goal is to continue yeah. to get better, to continue to
get measured.
Earn more, to continue. So when you talk about an administrator getting paid too much
So this I just picked one out at random, okay? So I'm not going to name the name because, whatever. Local experience, 21 years. Total experience, 22 years. Salary, 66,000. Benefits, 31,000.
So is your claim that the teacher is getting paid too much?
I'm not making a claim. I just, most of them make more than $40,000 a year. And that's without, that's aside
I
from benefits.
I think
benefit.
I disagree with that. Well, yes, most teachers don't stay in
so
the
you disagree
teaching
with
20 years anymore.
Well, you're pulling up a few teachers. I think we're
in
speaking
one school.
In general in the school district. Well, that's not true.
Most are making, I picked out one school, an average. I mean, it just at random.
And this is
I'll
a school
a
that's
one.
Not in an inner city. I mean, they have.
Let's pick out a different one. What's an inner city one?
So are we here to debate how teachers get paid too much?
Well, I just don't like things being, like, I don't like misinformation being spread. So most of them make more than $40,000 a year.
Most of them.
After 20 years of experience, that's.
This one, they were making, that person's making $100,000 salary and benefits.
The reality is that most teachers are not lasting 20 years, and most teachers aren't even lasting five at this point, and that is the problem. Okay. And honestly, I think if a teacher's been there
is
for
it?
20 years, yes, and if a teacher's
well,
been there
well,
for
we
20
had,
years,
we had flat
and they've
results.
Done really good work, and they have committed to the job, and they are actually, you know, they're doing great things, why wouldn't they deserve $57,000? But the reality is most of those teachers are not lasting that long.
Right.
And what is that problem? Why is that? What's the problem? Why aren't they?
Well, most people don't last in any field that long. People change careers now. Like that's a common thing. Most people have three or four careers in their life. Like that's
if you want to compare educators to other professions, that's fine. But in other professions, experience usually does equal a larger income.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I mean, always.
You have more experience, you have more to offer, and your salary increases. That's just a normal progression. I don't know why teachers should be different.
They shouldn't be. They should be evaluated.
They are, evaluated.
And they're heavily. And their salary should be based on their evaluations.
Which is probably true as well.
I don't see any indication of that. And they make
on that website.
This is the public. These are the publicly submitted. They didn't make these numbers up. They did not make up the $63,781.
So what is it you'd like to see on there instead?
I don't care about seeing anything. It was just,
you do though. You're laughing about it
because mm-hmm. it was said that the average elementary school teacher does not make over $40,000. They do.
Their benefits.
But
that is not true.
High.
The average teacher right now
in Green
does
Bay.
Not make
in Green Bay.
No.
Okay, where are you getting that information?
From the people that are my clients, from the fact that I have two parents that when they were educators and that they have friends who are still in education. I have friends who are teachers. I have clients that are teachers. I have all kinds of people in my life that are teachers, and I can tell you for a fact that is not true.
And also, most teachers work multiple jobs just because they're not able to make enough to meet their needs when they have family. Mm-hmm.
They're coaching kids after mm-hmm. school till 6 o'clock at night. They're traveling with speech teams.
I Googled Green Bay public school salary. So, I mean, I guess you can dispute Google because
you were so Trump about this. It's kind of scary.
Well, the box came up and it said the 50th percentile is $51,611. That's the salary before benefits. Most people do not make that much money. So, like this.
Does that indicate with the fact that they're actually coaching? And are you're talking about.
You get paid extra for coaching.
And also, you also have to understand.
No, you don't get paid extra.
Yes, you do.
The
it's
level
like
$100.
How much? Yeah,
it's not significant.
No, it's not at all.
What's not significant?
Coaching pay?
No, not at all.
But they get paid.
Like how much would it's?
I don't
really
know.
Not to pay for the time that's put in.
No, absolutely not.
That's fine, and we have great teachers, but we have a problem.
What is the problem?
Mm-hmm. We're not keeping up with the rest of the world. We are not.
So maybe we
should. Know that.
Maybe we pay them more. We actually would be more of an incentive.
We're already paying more than average. The average salary is $45,000. We're paying 50 percentile, $51,000 plus very good benefits.
And we haven't even talked about the level of education that's required to teach and ongoing education.
Well, maybe that's part of the issue.
And the great debt that's incurred before they become teachers.
What was your point, Elliot, about that too? Maybe that's part of the.
I don't think that we need to have a PhD candidate to be a fourth grade math teacher. I don't think we need that. I don't think. The level of education makes you a better or worse teacher.
So what is it that if somebody came to you?
My brother's a teacher, okay? And studies have shown that younger teachers relate better to students.
And for full disclosure, you should say that you are teaching as well.
And I also teach, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what should you, because I know you seem to have a problem with
I have a problem with us putting schools on lockdown when they're public facilities.
No.
And I have a problem with us not judging teachers on their merits.
What do you believe?
I can judge them on my merits.
What do you believe we should do? If someone wants to be a teacher, okay, and these women are running for school board, what should they be evaluating individuals on in regards to being able to walk into a classroom and teach? Tell them what you feel they should.
So part of it should be test results.
Person.
And part of it should be.
No, a person that walks in the door and I have a resume, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'm walking up and I'm saying, I want a job.
Yeah.
What should these people come to the table with?
So one thing is I do not think, and nobody cares about my opinions. We care about your opinions, right? But
I care about your opinions, Elliot.
Well, I don't want people to care about my opinions. I just want to ask questions, right? But don't you think that we should be more open-minded on who we let in as teachers instead of less open-minded?
I think it's a very slippery slope when you start.
Trust our $100,000 paid principals to make those hiring decisions? And if not, why do we pay them so much?
Like I said, I think it's a slippery slope when you start wiggling around on teacher requirements as far as education and vetting and all the things that most teachers have to go through.
So who should make that decision, though? Who should make that determination? Because we want more individualized education, right? So who should make this determination of what the qualifications are for a particular school? The principal? The school board? the person in Washington? Like, who?
It's a combination of those right now.
Why?
Why?
Why can't we allow more flexibility in our schools? Why can't we let teachers teach more of what they want and principals hire more of who they want?
Principals usually are in charge of the hiring for their schools. Okay. And then once they've gone through the interview process, then after that, they're approved by the school board or their superintendent. But principals are at the forefront of the hiring. Usually there are interview teams, so teachers that are in the school, sometimes parents, they're on the interview process to hire teachers.
But we still have it covered. So what would you like to walk in the door? Again, I'm Joe, you know, Schmo, and I want to be a teacher at Alda Leopold School. And I don't have a PhD or what should this person, what should their resume look like? I mean, I know this is a conversation that's out there, and this isn't just you.
It depends on the discipline. Isn't just you. It depends on what they're teaching. It depends on who they're teaching.
They want to teach math. So I want to teach math, and I want to teach at Aldo, and I'm not going with the formula of what's there right now. You know, the conversation of we don't need people to have, you know, degrees. What should they come with?
Just like anybody else does when they hire, you evaluate. That's why we're paying principals so much money, to evaluate that. They shouldn't just throw money at the problem. They should be.
But if you don't have a degree, okay, you don't have a degree.
Well, I didn't say they can't have a degree. I'm saying that we are close. And what should they have a degree in? They should have a PhD in mathematics and a PhD in education. I mean, what is that serving?
I don't think people are saying PhD. I think the conversation is even just degree in general. Okay. That's what it is, right?
License.
So my licensing thing is kind of an issue. So my brother went. He has a social studies license. The local schools have a need for math teachers. He can't even substitute for some of these. Like, that's kind of crazy, isn't it?
What's
like,
crazy?
Why can't we loosen that up?
But well, what's I'm crazy? Sure he could substitute. He well, probably just couldn't teach full time.
I don't know.
I think so.
Okay. So he can substitute for anything, mm-hmm. social studies.
At this point, because there's such a shortage of subs.
Yeah, right. They have to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't see that, really. I don't see that happening.
It is happening. So, I actually have a client who's doing it right now.
Okay. Mm-hmm. In Green Bay.
In Green Bay.
Okay. So he has to, he's subbing in Oneida.
Actually, I couldn't even talk to her today because she was working.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I mean,
subs just have to be, they just have to have a college education. They don't have to have a license in teaching at all.
Okay.
I mean, that's already happening to some degree.
Right.
And especially, you know, knowing the shortage of people that, you know, why do I want to go into a field where I'm criticized if I want to make more money or, you know, I'm told that I have to teach
if it's just based
exactly
on how long you've
same.
Been working. That's the problem I think people have. It's based on how long they've been working. And I don't think that serves anybody. No,
and
no
do you
other
know
business
for a
does
fact
that.
That's actually why they're being paid a higher
that's
wage?
That's how it's always happened.
But that's the only reason. That's the only consideration out
well,
there.
They've survived not getting fired. Yeah.
Is because...
Well, I mean, if you look at the list, the ones that are getting paid have been there the longest.
But you're just saying paid, this person is
the
working...
The teachers that have been there that long are there because they love working with kids. And to them, it doesn't
So they don't all like working with kids?
They do. Otherwise, they wouldn't be in that...
You have to
that
working
long.
With kids. Let's be real. You are parenting other people's children. So if you would not be in that job, if you didn't have what it takes to do that job, I mean,
you wouldn't stay.
It's beyond just teaching. It's,
so we
it's
don't have
parenting kids.
We don't have unlimited money. So are you going to cut principal salaries? Like, what are we paying these principals so much money for then?
Well, in any job, when you work up in the system, you get an education, you spend your years. You want to achieve something to a higher degree, and a principal is something that you work up to.
Well, we
if
don't.
We
pay,
just
we
didn't
don't,
have any sort of.
But we pay Aaron Rodgers more than we pay Mike McCarthy. So why can't we pay teachers more than principals?
I think sports is a terrible example because
why? It's a meritocracy where things are measured, and we pay a player more than we pay their management. Why? Like, why can't we do that?
Go ahead and try to change the system. I don't know. I don't
understand why we things are not improving.
Principals are in charge of a lot more things in a school than a teacher. A teacher is in charge of their classroom.
Okay.
And a principal is in charge of a lot more.
And they're answering to parents constantly on a daily.
So our teachers.
Yeah, but the principal is the person in charge, and they're the go-to person if something goes really wrong.
So maybe we need to evaluate the principals and pay them based on their school performance.
I don't know what to tell you, Elliot.
I mean,
and it's not even a clean slate with that because
the fact
that every
I
think it depends on how
we measure ourselves against other countries.
It's the tools of measurements. I mean, we all know this, right? Every school is different. Every school is measured differently. The tools of measurement are never going to be the same.
So Finland isn't beating us.
Okay, Finland and inner city Green Bay. I don't know. I don't personally know that.
So
how to compare the
so
two.
So there's no inner city Helsinki?
I mean, we don't actually,
I don't understand.
They probably have better health care, so they're healthier to teach. I don't know.
They also have a different attitude socially as a country toward education.
So how do we do that?
They're not pitting themselves against their education system. I mean, that's a fact. Education has been, the boogeyman at this point in the last few years. And you said, why are things improving? I'll tell you why things aren't improving. Things aren't improving because of the fact that we are constantly taking the resources away from public schools. Mm-hmm. Why are we doing that? What world would we ever take money away from something expected to thrive? Mm-hmm. That's not possible. So,
and when
again,
you think about
what are we doing with that?
We have like,
why are we doing it?
56% of the kids in the Green Bay schools are living in poverty.
Exactly.
They come to school without their basic needs being met. And then we have teachers who are expected to meet and get them all to the exact same level when they're not coming to the table at the exact same level. So there's a problem with our whole society when we're allowing 56% of our kids to be growing up in poverty.
Well, I don't want them all to end up at the same level. I want our best kids.
You want them all measured. You want them measured and tested at the same level, and that's what's actually happening right now, and that's what the Walker administration has implemented.
Well, I'm not Walker.
Okay, and I'm not saying you are. I'm just saying the Walker administration has administered tests for this school and this school. It's the exact same test, but we have completely different students and we expect great results from both schools. That is not realistic, and that is exactly what's happening right now, and mm-hmm. that needs to change.
And it's not even the tests aren't even taken in their own language. A lot of the students
Okay, we're going over time a little bit on this because this is a very important election coming up, and it's a subject that's it's an intense subject because there's obviously very different ideas coming from all directions in general, even mm-hmm. not just in this room but in general. So can we quick get to the referendum, because that is something that I personally I'm supportive, but honestly I haven't seen much of it anywhere. I haven't seen it advertised much. I haven't seen a lot of discussion. Maybe you have. I just haven't, and I feel like I'm in touch with these things. Is this something that they're doing this on purpose not to market
are? No, you'll see a lot of stuff about it in the coming weeks until the election. And also I would direct everyone to the Green Bay School District website. There's a ton of information there. I brought some of it with me today. It will explain a lot about what's going to be going on with these two referendums. And also just, we can't really stress this enough. Your taxes aren't going to go up because of these referendums. They've structured their debt over the years in a way that a lot of that is going to be ending. And so, and it will allow for these referendums to pass and not increase the mill rate.
Yeah, that's actually the very first thing on the school district website.
So let's talk about what's on, what's the $68.25 million that's used for the referendum. Relief for overcrowding in several East Side schools is on there. Baird Elementary, security upgrades, some fine arts programs at some schools. These are things that, the $68 million is going to go towards. Are you both in support of that?
I definitely am. We have many schools that need more space. They're like Baird School has 200 kids beyond capacity. The kids have to walk through bathrooms to get to the art room. Edison School has a cafeteria that is completely inadequate for the number of students it serves. They're looking to build a new cafeteria so all of the kids can adequately eat lunch. Seems like a basic need. And then change the current cafeteria to more classrooms to accommodate for some of the overcrowding there. Martin Elementary, I just recently toured that, and their autistic program takes place in the hallway because they don't have space for adequate space for the students that are there.
So other districts sometimes deal with the space issue with your own school. How are we looking at that?
I don't think it's on the agenda right now.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm sure we could go around most schools and we could find ways to improve everything. When was Baird Elementary
built? Well, I mean, that's a very common thing, though. Like, that happens all
the time. Do you know when Baird Elementary was built?
In the 60s, I believe.
Yeah, it's not one of the oldest schools, but the way that at that time, it was built in a way to be an open concept school. And I think after further research, it was found that that wasn't working. So through the years, they've remodeled it. And there isn't one square corner in the entire building. So they aren't able to really make a lot of space with the building that they have. And they have done studies just to look at the costs. And it was figured that the costs would be really more to remodel what's already there than to tear it down and build a new one.
So what are you hearing? Are you hearing from people on support of this referendum? Like, what are you hearing out there?
Well, I've been talking to a lot of people, and I think they're a lot like you in that they're still kind of not sure. They haven't heard enough information. But people who have children in the school district who see the need every day and witness it every day, I think they're going to get behind these referendums. They're absolutely necessary. If they don't pass, it will be a chilling kind of thing over our whole district.
Mm-hmm. So there will be teachers that will be relieved of their jobs.
I think they're estimating about 150.
Right. So that's a fact. So I would also say, you know, obviously the referendum is on the ballot, as well as the school board election. Historically, our April elections are very low. We have very low voter turnout. Mm-hmm. It's nice that there is a referendum on there to get people to come out, because typically that does raise the numbers. And, you know, you referenced me. I obviously support this, but for people that aren't even sure and don't even know there's a referendum, what do you know how they're going to get the word out? Do you know what they're doing, the school district?
Mm-hmm. Right now, my network is a lot of the parent network, and there is a group called Yes, Yes to Success, and they're working really hard to fundraise because you can't get the word out without the money to do it. It's very expensive. And so we've been working really hard to get the materials needed to get the information to the general public. I know that they're looking at doing some spots and billboards on one of the local TV show or TV news networks. And you'll be seeing yard signs popping up, and lots of people have been going door to door passing out information. And a lot of the parent networks at each school have been on any public night conferences, solo ensemble, having tables and trying to get people one by one to talk about the referendum.
Is there anything else you'd like to add? The fact that you're running for school board election and knowing there's not a lot of people that typically turn out for these, you know, how are you going to motivate people to get out and vote for you? Laura, we'll start with you.
Well, I've been, you know, it's just focusing on my campaign. I've got a Facebook page. I've been attending all the school board meetings. I've been talking to as many people as I can about these issues. This podcast is part of that. There'll be a League of Women Voters forum that's coming up in a couple weeks toward the end of March.
Do you know the date of that by any chance yet?
I can.
28th.
The 28th. So there's a school board election forum on the 28th of March. Where?
No, this is a League of Women Voters forum for the candidates.
Right.
And then, but there are two large informational meetings, I believe, at Martin. And that's in the third week of March. You can get that information off the website. There's one on a Tuesday night and one on a Thursday night. And the public is invited to come.
And where is the forum? Where is that at? In
at the public library.
It is. So it's mm-hmm. at the downtown library.
And their auditorium there.
Okay.
The dates of those informational meetings are March 14th and 16th. The first one is at Jackson Elementary, and the second one is at Martin Elementary. I would really urge people to come to those.
March 14th, and what was the other date? I'm sorry.
16th. Okay. March
16th. It's a Tuesday and then a Thursday. So that they'll have presentations and a lot of information for anyone who might be really wanting to do a deeper dive on these referendums. Just really, really important. Can't really stress that enough. So
great. That's it. Anything else to say before you wrap up?
I just would like to say one more thing. I know that there's a lot of negativity about public schools right now, but I just want to assure any listeners, anyone watching, that there is a small army of people in this community of teachers and administrators and staff who are working every day very hard to educate our children. Mm-hmm. And they need your support and they need your input. And they welcome that. But the more I get into this, the more I realize that there's a lot of good news about Green Bay schools. All you have to do is come to a school board meeting, visit a school, talk to a principal. They love to show off their schools. I've been learning that as I make my way through some of these schools. It's inspiring. It's really inspiring. And the challenges they have are deep. And they do it with a smile.
I can't imagine doing that job.
It's really inspiring. Mm-hmm. It really is. I'm sure, you know, just check into it.
Okay. So how would you like people to find out more about you guys or to get in contact with you if they have questions?
Currently, I have a Facebook page. I'm hoping to have a website up shortly.
And what is your Facebook page?
Heidi for School Board. And I have been at a lot of the conference nights passing out papers to talk about the referendum. I have an email, heidiforschoolboard@gmail.com. So any questions, people can feel free to address them through there.
My contact information, I have a Facebook page, Laura McCoy for Green Bay School Board. And my Gmail is lauramccoy10@gmail.com. And people can reach me that way.
Great.
Thank you.
Awesome. So that wraps up. I don't even know where to look. I think it's that camera. That wraps up episode 67 of Political Radar. And if you would like to read these beautiful show notes that I'm putting together, you can go to politicalradar.com/67. Also, Daniel said I have to talk about the Political Radar shop where you can get awesome gear. We have t-shirts and stickers and all sorts of other, stuff like that. That is politicalradar.com/shop. And I would encourage everybody to get into the Political Radar community and talk with us there. And that's all I got. You got anything to add?
Nope. You can reach me on Facebook and @SitNickHow on Twitter. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks for being on, guys.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for listening to Political Radar. To ensure that you never miss an episode, subscribe on iTunes or your favorite podcast app. To stay up to date, visit politicalradar.com or connect with us on Facebook or Twitter.